We're going to put a clownfish harem in here. It might not work, but we're going to try. Episode 4 of the Aquaforest Presents series, the scape, and the sand, and the rest of the equipment, and the fishless cycle. But that's it. A big thank you to Marine Depot, to Coral View, Reef Octopus, and Aquaforest for sponsoring this video. If you'd be so kind to consider subscribing and liking this video. And of course, as always, links to everything I'm gonna show you in this video are in the description below. All right, this is the sand we're gonna use. I've never used it before. It's an Aquaforest AF bio sand. It's done a little bit differently than some of the others. It comes dry, but check it out here. It comes with these two bottles, and you're supposed to rinse the sand first, right? You gonna focus? No? You're supposed to rinse the sand first with RODI water, which I'm gonna do, and then you're supposed to pour this in and let it sit in there with salt water for like a day, but I'm not gonna do that because we're gonna try to get everything set up today. Sand, it looks really similar, I'd say, to like the Fiji pink. It has a pretty fine grain. It's a little bit bigger. Like, there's a lot of sugar fine sand in the Fiji pink, and this doesn't seem to have any of that sugar fine. It does have some like bigger pieces in there that are colored. I see some purples and some oranges, but it's really a pretty white one, and there aren't any of those really big pieces that you get in the Fiji pink. If I had to say, it's closer to Fiji pink than it is to the special grade. Got sand rinsed quite a few times. I used quite a bit of water, actually. It's not gonna be perfectly clear, but I think it'll be good enough. This is a 50 or 55 gallon drum, and I'm gonna start cycling the tank today. The tank is, I wanna say, 48 gallons plus 20 gallons, so it's gonna be, what, 70 gallons? So I'll probably need like 50 gallons, so I think I just need to make sure that I have a full thing of RODI water. That was two bags, and each bag is 16 and a half, so that's what, 33 pounds in this 48 gallon tank. And if we wanna measure how deep did the sand bed get, let's see here. Looks like it's about a 1 inch deep sand bed, which is fine, which is perfect. I don't want a deep sand bed. I like to have some sand in here. I have two types of rock to use, and the original plan was to go with this lighter pink, which is the Aquaforest rock. It's human made. It's definitely different than the other rock we're gonna talk about. And the plan was to go with this rock, but the problem is when I decided to build an anemone tank, a harem tank, I noticed a problem. And it's not a problem with the rock, it's a good rock. The problem is there aren't any nooks and crannies for anemones to sink their feet into. I mean, like, the biggest one you have that I see is like right here, and I can't even get my pinky in there. In comes Marine Depot. I asked them if they could send me some other rock, and this rock, I'm sure many of you recognize, this is the Carib Sea Life Rock. And this rock has a darker purple color, which I actually like a little bit better. I don't mind this rock, but it has more nooks and crannies. Not as good as like actual live rock, since this is also human made, but I think it's gonna be a better fit. So I have an entire box of the Life Rock down here, and then an entire box of the Aquaforest Rock, and I'm going to use a combination of both of them. Probably going to put more of the Aquaforest as the base, and then the Carib Sea Life Rock on top of the base, so I can have spaces for all the anemones to sink their feet into. So I've already outlined the dimensions, which I already put down here, so I know the exact dimensions. I may have enough rock right here, which is the Carib Sea Life Rock, but if I need to, I can use some of the Aquaforest rock as well. I want to create a scape that goes from end to end, front to back, with just enough gap to allow for an algae scraper. I typically like to use all the vertical space, but I'm only gonna go halfway up because the hope is gonna be a stable, level, kind of flat aquascape with a lot of crevices for anemones to sink their feet into, and then they'll extend up toward the light, and then that gyre pump will do a nice little pulsing action to give them the indirect flow that they need. I'll tell you what, this is nothing amazing. This scape really just looks like a big jumble of rocks. It has a lot of swim throughs though. I wish this rock had a little bit more nooks and crannies for anemones to sink their feet into, but it just doesn't. I believe I have it like up to 9 inches, which is a little bit higher than I wanted, but it seems to fill the front, back, left, right, just okay. Some of these pieces, like right here, are completely flat on the bottom. So I'm gonna see if I can find some rubble rock and put some feet on them. Just a few of these pieces that are really flat. So this piece here, this Aquaforest live rock piece, is just totally flat. So there would be no habitat possibility, detritus buildup. So all I did is I took 3 pieces of rubble rock and I attached it with a little bit of this coralline color epoxy. And then just to make sure it was secured in place, I also used some of the Marine Depot Max Secure. Okay, that's the scape. It's okay. That's kind of what my goal was. Side to side rocks, just enough space to get an algae scraper in. I might have to push that rock. Actually, look at that. It's a little bit too close right there. Let's climb up here real quick and kind of show you guys the top down view. It's actually turning out okay. Underneath all these big rocks here is empty space. So if you can kind of see through here, it'll provide like some really good swim throughs and space. I thought that the gyre was gonna be the way to go. Like look there, see that? But now I'm worried that the gyre is going to be blasting too much water at the tops of any nems over there. So I may end up going back to these octopulses, because then I could put one octopulse here kind of on the back, and then I could put one octopulse here and then just kind of get that circular flow. So we'll see. This tank is too small. This is a 48 gallon tank, and most online resources say don't try a clownfish harem tank unless the tank is more than 70 gallons. But I've never seen somebody try a clownfish heron tank on a 48 gallon tank. This is a 40 gallon breeder tank, right? The dimensions are almost exactly the same. This tank holds a lot of fish. And in order to make a clownfish heron tank work, or at least to attempt to make it work, they need 3 things. One, they need to be fed a lot. I'm gonna feed them 4 times a day. They need to have 2 feet of space to get away. So the hope is that since this is over 30 inches, that the aggression can be spread out. And not only that, I'm hoping that because I'm gonna put as many anemones as possible in here, I mean 15, 20 anemones in here, all bubble tips, that they will be able to have enough habitat either in an anemone or hiding underneath the rocks. Plenty of cool little caves to go into. Up here, the only equipment that I have is the razor light, which I'm gonna keep off during the cycle. And then I have the gyres, the 330 up here. And then yesterday I went ahead and did some work just to get a little bit of a jump start. It's not pretty. I know that. I know it's not pretty. And this whole area right here is really empty because I have tomorrow or the next day, a buddy of mine who's gonna come and bring just, I don't know, 20 pounds of live rock, seeded live rock with good, bad, everything in it. And I'm gonna seed this tank with real live rock. I installed a temperature probe, used a waterproof temperature probe attached to my favorite Bayite temperature controller. Over here, I have the one lone titanium heater. I still have to pick up a second heater for that. You'll see this. This is new. I haven't used this one before. I think it's really cool. It's a Wi-Fi outlet. So it actually has 5 Wi-Fi outlets and 5 always on outlets. But this was a perfect amount to be able to attach my return pump to, my skimmer to, my temperature controller to. And then this is the ballast for the lights. I went ahead and just screwed it onto here. And then we have the controller for the gyre right there.
For salt mix, I've switched all my tanks to the Aquaforest Reef Salt. They actually sell a couple different kinds, but I've been doing it for about 2 months already and it's working really well. And the autofocus, FYI, is the worst. All right, let's mix some more up. I'd say we probably got about 30 gallons left to put in there.
Here's my app I'm using to control the Wi-Fi smart outlet, and just for fun, I turn on the return pump, and just so you can see, the return pump comes out of those holes right there. You ready? I was shocked at how much flow comes out. Look at that. Look how much flow that thing puts out. Are you kidding me? That is awesome. Wow. Okay, so that little Reef Octopus return pump is amazing. I'm not done, but I'm pretty close to done. You can see the water's already clearing up. The biggest problem I had was really down here in the sump. I've been working on it for like an hour and a half now. The hard plumbing right here, it comes with plumber's tape on it, but I found this plumber tape, there was not enough. So it was leaking. It was leaking on two separate spots and it was in as hard as I could possibly turn it. So I pulled it out, I put some more plumber's tape on, thought it was enough, put it back in. I solved one of the leaks, but then the other one needed more. Like, just FYI, you have to use copious amounts of plumber's tape to screw in the threaded hard PVC into the bulkhead. And now I just restarted it again and I hope it's gonna work. We've added the sand, we've added the rock, we've added all the equipment, and it's fishless cycling. So let me turn you around and show you. This is the primary drain line, and this is the secondary. Typically, I put the secondary drain line above the water level so that I will know when it's dripping, but it doesn't matter how you adjust it. This one, the emergency line always has some flow. So if I put this out, you can hear it all the time, which is kind of annoying. I wish I would have cut it a little bit lower, and you could be like, oh, just adjust the Herbie. Well, I've adjusted the Herbie and it still drips. So it's how it's designed. So I'm just putting it in the filter sock for now, just so it's not super annoying sounding. Protein skimmer works like a charm. I'm not going to turn it on yet. I'm gonna let the beneficial bacteria that I put in, give it 24 hours before I turn this on. I have the gyre right over here. I have it set to the lunar cycle. You'll notice here I have two temperature controllers. This is the titanium temperature controller. This is set to 80 degrees, but I have this plugged into my Bayite, which I know is kind of ridiculous and redundant, but I like to have it really, really accurate. So the temperature's climbing. This is the gravity auto top-off unit. I had to push it down a little bit, but it seems to be working right now. I'm probably gonna end up adding my own auto top-off bucket. Like, if you look over here, here, look at this, see this? This is a 5 gallon bucket I have on the 40 gallon tank, right? And I go through that pretty quickly. And this over here, this is where you pour the auto top-off in, right? And this little tiny spot right here is where you pour it in. You get like a gallon and a half, and that's just not gonna be enough. So I think what I'm probably gonna do is put another bucket right down here and then just bypass the built-in gravity and just put an auto top-off unit down there myself. I think the scape turned out pretty good, actually. It's clearing up already. I rinsed that sand out. I like that sand. It's the sand, I looked it up. It's 0.5 to 1.5, so it is truly in between the Fiji pink and the special grade. My goal with this tank is to set it and forget it. I want my anemones to be happy. I'm an anemone killer. I don't know why, I just am. And so what I wanna do is I want to have it temperature stable. I wanna have a water change every single week. I wanna have this exact same flow pattern, the exact same lighting pattern, and I just wanna not mess with it. Well, that last take did not work because I didn't have the microphone facing me. I have the tank starting to cycle. I'm using a fishless cycling, but I got the Dr. Tim's ammonia chloride in there. Had to put in like 200 drops for the size of the tank it was. And then I don't have the Dr. Tim's one and only, but I do have the Microbacter Start XLM. So I go ahead and dosed that as well. So the tank is going, there's ammonia in the tank, there's live nitrifying bacteria in the tank, the tank is cycling. My buddy Dave's coming over later this week and he's bringing me actual live rock with all sorts of critters on it. I've never done this before, but I'm going to. I need to stop being scared of nuisances because you know what? I think the pros are gonna far outweigh the cons, especially when it comes to a harem tank with really sensitive anemones. I wanna seed this tank with a whole array of beneficial bacteria, more than you can just get from a bottle. Morning, everybody. It's 2 days since I put this together. You can probably tell because I shaved the growing beard off. I just can't handle beaters. They just get too itchy on the neck. Anyway, I'm gonna flip this around. I wanna show you guys the five auto feeders I'm testing. This isn't like a full review of all of the automatic feeders. I just wanted to point out which ones I'm testing. I'll do a full review later, but we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. On this side, okay, we have 2 Eheim feeders. This one's a double, right? This thing lifts up right here, and I'll show you how they work here in a second. And then the one back here is just a single. You can purchase this little cheap plastic platform, and then these just sit on top. You can press the Eheim button on the top. You can program it, I think, up to 4 times. And then you can just adjust this little thing on the bottom here. But really, here's how this one works, okay? I'm just gonna go over, I'm gonna press the button, and all her glory. Ready? Very, very silent, very, very nice. This one, okay, it has you can feed 2 separate foods. I put pellets in here, dry pellets, and that didn't work. Dry pellets made the little mechanism gunk up. This Eheim, oh my gosh, it is like, I feel like you need a master's degree just to learn how to program it. But luckily, you can just press each of these buttons to control the different sides. So let's do that. See that? Pretty fancy. This one I got from Amazon, very similar to the other Eheim ones by Zacro. They're all similar prices, except for this one. This one's more expensive. I don't know, they're all like $20 to $35, somewhere around there. I like this one from Amazon because the battery is just rechargeable lithium ion. Not very exciting, completely silent, which I really like about that one. This lifeguard one, again, comes with a rechargeable lithium ion battery and has manual setting as well. So here's this one. I also don't have a feeding ring here, so let's just see what this one looks like. Ready? And all its out of focus glory. Completely silent, like this one as well. Now the last feeder is from Current. It has a more compact foot, so it doesn't stick out as far. And I am using this one with the magnetic feeding ring. I don't know what you call it, but it's an Aquamax one so that all the food just kind of stays right up top. But let's give this one a shot. And there it is. We'll test them all out. I'll give you a full review on these in about a month or so. This protein skimmer is a beast, but I had to raise it up because I'm just trying to break in the protein skimmer right now. And when it was all the way down, it was overflowing a huge amount. So I've just raised it up and that seems to help quite a bit. Really, I just want to get this broken in and ready. Because I'm going to run the protein skimmer all the time, I want the biological filter to be steady, and I want to make sure that I'm not zeroing out my nitrates or my phosphates. So it's just important that I run this all the time and adjust my feeding accordingly. Next up down here, you can see this is the baffle. You have to put the baffle in the right way. I put it in the wrong way the first time and it didn't work. So you need to have the plastic, see this? You need to have the wall side facing the skimmer. It just needs to be facing this way, or else for some reason the water pressure just topples it right over. Another mistake I made, I mean, it's not a mistake, but it's not ideal. See all those bubbles coming down over the wall? And look what I did. I put the pump facing the bubbles. So what's happening? I'm getting tons of bubbles up here. And I'm gonna have to cut a new piece of flexible tubing, because what I should have done is I should have turned the input from the return pump to the other side over here so that it gets less bubbles. No big deal, but sort of annoying as well. The last things I really have to do, if you look up there, are the lights. I bought a PAR meter, but I'm gonna leave the lights off until we're getting closer to the time, just to avoid nuisance algae growth. But I will be testing the PAR meter. I really want the light, the PAR readings, to be right at the top of the rock work, around 150 PAR. And I'm gonna set up a 7 to 8 hour photo period for the tank, but I'm gonna have the lights on for like 12 hours. So I'm just gonna, like, at 5 o'clock when the photo period ends, I'm gonna drastically reduce the lights from like 75% intensity down to 10% intensity, just so that I can at least have some pleasant viewing in the evening and it's not just a dark tank when people get home from work. So that'll be the lights. The gyre is right up here. I'm gonna either make a decision to keep it on like the automatic lunar cycle, or I'm gonna set it up for a constant pulse. It's like, you know, like just like a wave. But I'm gonna wait until the anemones go in, make that decision, and then I'm not gonna change it, period. Because I just have a bad habit of changing it, and anemones evidently really like
consistency. And then in a few weeks before we get our clutch of clownfish, I will be adding like a sand sifting goby, maybe some brittle starfish, some nassarius snails, stuff like that, to really help with the sand bed, because right now all the food that I'm feeding four times a day is just collecting down there, so it'll be really nice to have some food. I'm also gonna be adding several bottles of copepods just to help seed the tank as well, to really make it settle in before I add the clownfish. Clownfish, I'm assuming I'm gonna add in about a month, but it could be a little bit later because I have to find a clutch first. Hopefully I'm gonna get some pergola clownfish, 7 to 10 of them, and then I'm gonna add the anemones a month after that. And why am I doing that first? Well, because the anemones are more sensitive. So I want to add the fish, let it totally settle in, get the water parameters completely stable with my nitrates and phosphates exactly where I want them and constant before I add in the anemones, because they are definitely the most sensitive, especially when comparing them to, you know, the clownfish, which are super duper hardy. But anyway, you're probably not gonna get an update from me on this tank for about a month, but no, I'm gonna be diligently working and testing and doing some tweaks here and there. Thank you guys for watching. If you haven't subscribed yet, please do consider subscribing. We would really appreciate it. Happy reefing. We'll see you next time.